my glasses.
Great. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm glad to hear all the voices as we are walking in. Everybody is engaged here. So this panel is about immigration and the economy, so a big subject to cover. I am Shannon O'Neill. I'm a vice president for studies here at the Council of Foreign Relations, as well as the Nelson and David Rockefeller Senior Fellow for Latin America Studies. So I have looked at some of these immigration issues, particularly the countries where at least some of these immigrants are coming from. I have here with us an excellent panel, lots of expertise from different points of view. You all have their bios in your packets, so I will not go over them in detail, but I will just give you a heads up of who's who up here. We have Chad Sparber. He is the W. Bradford Wiley Chair in International Economics at Colgate University. And as you can guess from that title, he looks a lot at the economics of immigration here in the United States and perhaps elsewhere around the world as well. Next, I have Angela Banks. She is the Charles J. Miriam Distinguished Professor of Law at the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law at Arizona State University. She obviously looks at it from a legal perspective. And I just want to highlight, she had a book that came out last year. It's titled Reimagining Civic Education in the Age of Mass Migration. And then finally, last but not least, we have Alexandra Starr. She is one of our own. She's a senior editor here at Foreign Affairs at the Council on Foreign Relations. But she has had a long and illustrious career of 20 years of covering issues of immigration for all kinds of outlets. So has looked at these issues like you all do as a reporter on the ground in many ways. We will begin up here. We'll have a conversation for about half an hour, and then I'm going to open it up to all of you and to your questions. So please, as we go along, think about what you would like to ask any and all of them that would help you in the work that you do when you leave here from today after CFR. So to start our conversation, I want to start, not surprisingly, I guess, at the U.S. southern border, because this has been a focus of U.S. politics, and I dare say will be increasing focus as we get towards the midterms coming up in the fall. And there has been a sense, or at least a narrative that is out there, that since Biden came into office over a year ago, the numbers of migrants that are crossing the U.S. southern border has been on the rise and has been at, you know, significant highs. And indeed, if you look at the February CBP numbers, the Customs and Border Patrol numbers, there were 160,000 what they call encounters with migrants at the border, which does seem like a high number. But before we get all worried about that, I would like us first to turn to Alex. And Alex, could you put those numbers in a little bit of historical perspective? So are these trends, are we at all-time highs? Is this something that's been happening over time? And who is it that is showing up at the border today compared to perhaps in the past?
That's a big question.
I know. That's why I turned to you first.
And first, I want to say how thrilled I am to be in a room of working journalists. I know we are an endangered species these days, and I know the kind of hard work you guys put in under tough circumstances, and I'm thrilled to welcome you here. And I look forward to talking to you in greater detail at our breakout lunch. So to Shannon's question, why don't we just, I could start in the 1920s, but that's a long time ago. So let's go to, say, 1970s and 80s, when the Mexican economy was in a tailspin, and we saw more Mexicans coming across the border. A lot of that migration was circular. People would work seasonal jobs and then go back home. The border was patrolled extremely loosely, particularly compared to today. By 1986, there were roughly, I believe, 3 million undocumented Mexicans living in the United States, and that was the last year we had comprehensive immigration reform. And that happened under President Ronald Reagan, and roughly 2.7 million migrants were able to become U.S. citizens. I mean, it's funny to look at some of the talk around that legislation, because the idea was somehow that solved the issue. I mean, it was paired with more patrolling along the border, and for the first time, there were theoretically penalties for employers who employed undocumented migrants for jobs. Of course, what ended up happening is in the late 1990s, we had a big economic boom. And the numbers of particularly Mexican workers and, you know, people in the United States swelled. I believe by 2003, there were 11 million undocumented Mexicans in the United States. Now, since then, the numbers decreased in the 2010s, in part because of demographic changes in Mexico. People were having fewer children. The economy was on the upswing. What we started to see is more migrants from Central American countries, in particular, El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala. That has not abated. And now that the Mexican economy is in a swoon again, we're seeing more single Mexican men coming over to the United States. And now we're seeing Cubans, Venezuelans, and Nicaraguans. All three of those countries have horrific leadership. And I mean, people are desperate to get out. And so we should not expect under any circumstances for those immigration flows to abate, irrespective of what the US government does. So yeah, the numbers are high and I believe they're going to increase.
So you teased out there, if I'm right, some of the drivers of this. So talk a little bit about, if you would, what is driving either overall migration and or from particular countries, if you would. Just lay that out for us.
Sure. Well, part of the issue was that after the border was patrolled, you know, God, now like there are parts of it that really look like a military state, migrants no longer do that circular route, right? They're stuck. And so in a lot of cases, then they've sent for their families to join them. Also, I've seen this in the Honduran community, for example. Once someone makes it here, right, and makes enough money to send money home, and then their cousin or their younger brother or their mother wants to come, they're in a position to take out a big enough loan to pay the smuggler who brought them over to make the trip. So having people here then creates more venues for broader parts of that community to join them. And you know as well as I, like, the situation in El Salvador is bad. The situation in Honduras, I mean, it might pretend there's a new president in Honduras. Some people are a little bit optimistic, but things are not going to change overnight. Guatemala, what's interesting to me in reporting in the Guatemalan community is people there are not so nervous, in my experience, people there are not so nervous about being killed. It's that there is this enormous underclass in Guatemala that just, it's not uncommon for people to leave school in the second grade. You know, if they want any kind of future, they have to leave. And once they see people come to the United States and have a modicum of success, that is going to bring more people, you know, encourage more people to make the trip themselves.
Great. Angela, let me bring you in because, you know, as Alex was saying, we have the push of, you know, terrible economic conditions, no possibility there. We have the pool of the U.S. economy, which has been doing fairly well as the communities here where they have someone to come to. But another issue that Alex touched on here is how desperate and also some other issues, you know, worried about their safety, about violence, about other issues. So, you know, one of the things that we have seen, especially in the Central American community, but others, is coming not just for economic opportunity, but also for asylum. Now, I know you are an expert in this. And first I want to ask you, as I was looking at some of the numbers of asylum, as I read it, we have 1.5 million asylum cases pending in the United States. Mm-hmm. Does that seem like a reasonable number? And if not, why do we have so many pending?
Right, so that's a great question. And part of it is just a significant backlog we have throughout our immigration system right now. Things are terribly backlogged across the board. And so one of the places where we see this very significantly is in asylum cases. And so just as a quick backdrop, because I think one of the things that you mentioned that I think is really important is to think about the different reasons that people are migrating and thinking about historically, why do we have such high numbers in different categories? So just to back up, because one of the things you mentioned was sort of the importance of the 1970s. counties and seeing those numbers increase there. One of the really important things I think to think through is U.S. economic structure, and I'm sure you will talk much more about this, but also then people fleeing, seeking protection and a better life. And so the United States for many years had something called the Presider program, which was problematic in a lot of ways in terms of the way workers were treated, but it did provide a formal legal pathway for workers to come to the United States to do sort of low-wage work, particularly in the agricultural sector. The 1965 immigration reforms were sort of heralded as getting rid of a lot of the sort of racial and ethnic barriers to immigration that existed within the U.S. immigration system. But one of the things that it did do was create numerical limitations on the number of people that could migrate from the Western Hemisphere. Pre-1965, we didn't have limits on Western Hemisphere migration. And also what happened was the Bracero program ended, and there was no other temporary worker robust temporary worker program implemented. And so what you saw was significant, like, in effect, people who had been here working in the Bracero program, all of a sudden, when that law was passed, become unauthorized migrants in the United States because there is no longer a legal pathway for them to be here. And we just see that being exacerbated over time. So a lot of people who are looking to come for low-wage work that would provide a pathway for economic mobility for their families no longer exist. Then we move to people who are just fleeing terrible situations. Their physical safety is in danger. And under asylum law, if you have a fear of a well-founded fear of persecution or past persecution on account of race, religion, political opinion, membership in a particular social group or nationality, you can seek asylum in the United States. And one of the major ways that you seek asylum is that you present yourself at the border and you say, I'd like to seek asylum. You don't have to have a visa. You don't have to have gotten permission to enter the United States. It's perfectly lawful to just show up and say, I'd like to seek asylum. What that means is that you get a lot of people coming to the border to say, I'd like to seek asylum, and then those cases have to be adjudicated. And there has just been a significant backlog in getting those cases adjudicated by immigration judges to determine whether or not the individuals who are seeking asylum qualify under that sort of legal definition of who gets asylum.
Let me ask you, when I look at the immigration at the southern border the last 4+ years, many were seeking asylum, mm-hmm. and you also saw an influx of children, not just, mm-hmm. you know, adults coming to. The other thing is when I look at least the numbers coming from Central America, most of those cases are not successful. Could you talk a little bit about why they aren't? Is it because actually they're coming for these economic reasons so they don't, you know, qualify? Or is it, why are we not seeing successful cases? And is it different than, say, people seeking asylum from other places around the world?
That's a really great question. So I sort of gave you the very broad definition of experienced well-founded fear of persecution or experienced past persecution. And the way the law thinks about persecution, it doesn't encompass every sort of terrible thing that people experience in the world. And so, for example, if you're home country was devastated as a result of a natural disaster, that is not going to give rise to meeting the definition of persecution. If you are a victim of generalized violence, so perhaps there is armed conflict, gang conflict, et cetera, and you have not been targeted because of your race, religion, nationality, membership in a particular social group, et cetera, then you are not going to qualify for asylum. So part of the challenge is that a lot of the terrible conditions that people are fleeing, they are not sort of targeted victims on account of one of those five grounds, and therefore their asylum case may not be successful.
So for instance, in El Salvador, places where there are gangs that rule various neighborhoods, it's a hard case to make because that is not the state. Supposedly, that is a gang.
And that's another great point. So another piece of this is that it generally has to be, the persecution has to be attributed to the state. And in recent years, we've had some new legal precedent clarifying what constitutes state action in this context and making it much harder for individuals who are victims of private violence, so domestic violence, gang violence, to be successful in their asylum claims. And so that is another reason why it is harder for those individuals to be successful when seeking asylum.
Last question while we're just focused on this to sort of parse it out a bit. So Central America, since it's generalized violence or non-state violence, but quite strong actors, but not the state, Would you expect, we're seeing, for instance, hundreds if not thousands of Ukrainians show up at the border just in the last few weeks. We have seen, as Alex was saying, Nicaraguans, Venezuelans, Cubans, Haitians. Where do you see, in terms of seeking asylum, which groups would you, or nationalities would you expect to be more successful or not, and why?
So what's interesting is that our asylum law grows out of World War II. And sort of the idea of never again. And so it is a very sort of state-centric, wartime understanding of persecution. And so in many ways, Ukraine fits that definition, or that idea of people fleeing. They would be targeted because of their nationality. And so that fits much more tightly in our understanding of the legal definition of what would constitute asylum, depending on what's happening. So, you know, for example, membership in a particular social group is a very vague concept that has been defined by the courts and by immigration judges over the years. And so there are ways in which people have been able to use that category to find protection for individuals. For example, victims of domestic violence have been able to construct a particular social group that they are a member of, and the state not being providing protection or support for them, that being a viable claim for asylum. And so I think depending on what exactly is going on for the people who are fleeing in Cuba and Venezuela and other places, there might be ways that membership in a particular social group can be utilized to create successful pathways for asylum. But just in terms of our traditional sort of understanding, individuals fleeing the armed conflict in the Ukraine are sort of the classic examples of persecution.
Great. Chad, let me turn to you. Let's talk about when these immigrants get here, whether they come through asylum channels, whether they come seeking economic opportunity, whether they're here, you know, authorized or unauthorized, with or without visas or green cards and the like. And so, you know, as I look out, there are sort of three, I'm generalizing here, but sort of three narratives about immigration and the U.S. economy. And so one of those narratives is that immigrants steal jobs, right? Immigrant is bad for the U.S. economy, and particularly bad for particular sectors and types of workers in the U.S. economy. Another narrative is, the MIT graduates and the Elon Musks and Sergey Brins of the world, that's okay if they come, but we don't want the gardeners or the, you know, people who work in the restaurants and the like, that takes jobs. So there's sort of a differentiation here. And then there's another argument that is out there that actually immigration benefits the economy broadly, but also benefits the economy on a microeconomic level much more than it hurts. So I guess one is, as you look at these different narratives, where do you fall out? and give a little description why that is the case and the others are not right.
That's a good question. Briefly, the third narrative is the one that I fall into. Although I empathize with the other kind of perspectives. I should maybe first say that one of the interesting differences between us on this panel is that as you focus on the immigrant experience, I focus on that much less, and I'm really interested in how immigrants affect Americans and the American economy. So let's start with that empathy bit. So, if you know a little bit of intro to econ, you might have this understanding of the world where, like, okay, an immigrant comes in, they're going to work. That's an increase in supply. Whenever you see supply increase, the prices should come down somehow. That means immigrants come in, my wages are going to fall, right? And so that's kind of the thing that motivates a lot of anti-immigrant sentiment about that people have, right? They don't want immigrants stealing their jobs or reducing their wage opportunities and that sort of thing. And I respect that. The problem is, I think that narrative is wrong, that effectively that intro to econ story is too simple for understanding these really complex labor markets. There are a lot of reasons for that. The one that I tend to focus on, I guess in layman's terms, is that immigrants do jobs that Americans don't want to do. You mentioned gardeners, fine. I would also mention economists. That's an important bit, though, because I should say that there's a little bit of difference between whether we talk about workers with high school education or less versus markets where we're talking about workers that have some college experience or more. there are differences between those two markets, but also similarities. And in simple terms, we do have different, we specialize in different kinds of skills that then lead us to specialize in different kinds of jobs. And so when immigrants come into the country, it kind of creates an opportunity for a native-born worker to respond by moving into maybe higher-paying jobs, managerial jobs, and that sort of thing. So I don't want to drone on too much, so I should probably pause here and say, what more, if anything, would you like to know?
So let me ask you about one study that I saw that you had done. And in this study, you know, right, we get the sense that, okay, you know, Americans, generally speaking, are in kind of the middle skill area.
Okay.
Right? And we need the economists, I guess. and the other, you know, engineers and the like. And then we need, you know, those who will come in and you know, do other things and do the manual labor that, you know, many people don't aspire to or don't aspire that their children will do those jobs. But one of your studies that you showed that those that come in with STEM qualifications, or you know those you know engineers and others with those skills, that in the study that you looked at, they not only didn't displace Americans with those skills, but they actually raised the wages of Americans, of native-born Americans who had high school or less. So explain a little bit about what your findings were and how that happened, right? Why would that happen?
So there are a lot of moving parts here. The first thing I think to understand is just, as you kind of say, that when we're talking about highly educated immigrants, they have this comparative advantage or specialization in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. There are a lot of reasons for that. Some of it's immigration policy, the way that our laws are written. But some of it's like math is a universal language that goes across borders pretty well, okay? Well, one of the important things about understanding our STEM workforce is that these are the people who are really responsible for advancing our technological frontier, for generating long-term productivity growth. We were joking in aside, like, you know, Zoom, I don't really like it, but Zoom was really helpful in, you know, connecting with family during COVID, helping us work more than we otherwise would have been able to. Zoom was a technology that was invented by an immigrant here in the United States, right? And so these kind of, you know, technological discoveries or whatever, they have these wide-ranging applications that benefit all of us. You know, a lot of positive spillovers, if you like. So that's one way. Other ways I would cite just briefly is that immigrants start a lot of businesses kind of across the board that hire lots and lots of workers. They also do a lot of local consumption, so there's like a multiplier effect there where one STEM immigrant moves in, you get 2.5 jobs that are created in service industry, things that you know, support those workers. So that's, I guess, in a nutshell, some of the ways in which, yeah, high-skilled immigrants coming in benefit everybody.
Are there nuances to this that, you know, overall it's a benefit? Are there nuances here is it all a positive sum game? If you get immigrants that come in, then all boats are lifted? Or is there some nuance there to think about as well, as you think about communities that may have a large number of immigrants or maybe thinking about trying to attract immigrants or not?
So the nuance is exceptionally important. Okay, so economists, we talk in generalities a lot. You know, what's typical behavior, okay? And so a story that I might tell is that, immigrants at the low education end have a comparative advantage in manual skills, labor skills, or whatever. So suppose you're a native-born American construction worker, and an immigrant moves in. You might rationally respond to that by becoming a foreman or a construction manager, and that will pay a higher wage, and you really benefit from this, okay? This is the sort of maybe typical behavior that I might characterize as like, well, this is why immigration's good for the economy, okay? Well, what if you don't respond, right? What if, like, you've been an American-born construction worker for the last 30 years, right? That person, when they say that immigration has hurt their labor market opportunities, they're not lying, right? Like, and so there are these sort of distributional concerns that we should be worried about. Now, from a policy perspective, I don't think the right answer is, therefore we should close our borders. I think the right policy thing is, well, if you're concerned about these distributional aspects, you could redistribute some of the benefits from immigration from the winners to the losers or what have you. But that nuance can be lost when we're getting, immigration's good, immigration's bad. No, there are a lot of finer points, and I think it's important that we maintain empathy for those who have been adversely affected.
Given that we're trying to build empathy, I want to turn our conversation before we open it up to broader questions to a little bit about how one reports on this story, or what are the stories to tell, and how would you go about telling it well? And so I want to start on the policy side. So I'm going to turn to you, Angela. And I think there's a consensus up here on the panel, I'm daring to guess, and perhaps a consensus in the room, that the idea of a comprehensive immigration reform is dead. anyone who used to champion it a decade ago is gone from Congress or has changed their mind in terms of where they stand. And it is such an issue that it seems hard to imagine that we could it's hard to get a lot of anything through our Congress, but this in particular seems like a third rail. But that to me doesn't say that the immigration policy story is dead. And there may be other things that can be done, that will be done, either by the president, by the executive branch, perhaps by Congress, perhaps by local governments. So I want to turn to you, Angela. As you think about the policy space and the legal space, what is out there that's coming down the pike in the next months or a couple of years that you're watching and that you think needs to be told?
Yeah, so I think so Supreme Court. So thinking about, not only did we get a historic confirmation for a new Supreme Court justice yesterday, immigration's on the docket this year. And so the migration protection protocols, the Supreme Court agreed to take cert on this case a month ago or so. And so this was really dealing with the process, the procedures that are going to be used for asylum seekers in the future. So the migration protection protocol is a program that's implemented as a result of a provision within the Immigration and Nationality Act that allows the United States to say individuals who seek asylum by crossing the southern border or the northern border can be sent back to that country, so basically to Mexico, and wait there for their asylum case to be adjudicated. And the way this works is that the individual would sort of approach the border, say they're seeking asylum, be initially processed, then be returned to Mexico, and then they'd be given a date on which they'd have a hearing before an immigration judge. They would then, Customs and Border Patrol would pick them up at a marked location, bring them into the United States for their hearing, and then return them back to Mexico. There has been a lot of controversy around this program because of the experience that the migrants were having while in Mexico. Again, these are not Mexican citizens. These are individuals who were traveling generally through Central America to arrive. So they, don't have sort of family connections in Mexico. Communities were being developed that were then being targeted for violent crime, et cetera. The Biden administration terminated the program. Texas and, I'm blanking on the second state, sued to say that that was a violation of the administrative protection. So I won't get into the legal, the legal claims, but that it violated administrative law and also violated the terms of the immigration statute. And so both the district court and the Fifth Circuit said that the Biden administration was wrong in the way that it terminated the program, and the Supreme Court's going to decide this. So this really has implications for thinking about, as we see more individuals from the Ukraine and others are using the southern border as a way to enter the United States to seek asylum, what is that process going to look like? Are we going to require individuals to return to Mexico and wait in Mexico? Is that going to be part of the process? Is that going to be a disincentive for individuals, or et cetera? So I think that's one issue to keep an eye on. Another is thinking about what sort of maybe smaller areas could we see immigration reform happen. So, again, pathway to citizenship is very popular in the public for DACA recipients. Are there ways in which a pathway to citizenship will be offered or somehow something could be created even through Congress for smaller populations? So instead of the unauthorized migrant population as a whole, could something be crafted for DACA recipients? In light of the pandemic and extensive support for essential workers and recognizing how many immigrants and particularly undocumented workers were essential workers, might there be appetite for a pathway to citizenship for essential workers? Things like that, I think, are things to keep an eye on, sort of the smaller populations that there might be work for, and then also thinking about executive action as another pathway to provide protection, if not a pathway to citizenship, something like DACA that at least provides work authorization and or protection from deportation.
Chad, let me go to the economic side. As you think about with this audience here, if they want to tell the economic story, what are those stories that, that you think are the most interesting ones, or perhaps get this nuance that, that you were talking about? And how do you go about doing it? How would you go about doing it? Or when you study and you do the economics of it, how do you go about doing it?
I should be careful. I'm a little weird. Like, I love data. Personal human interest stories? Come on. but let me tell you some of the stories that are kind of exciting or interesting to me in ways that it's the unintended consequences of policy that kind of go, I wouldn't have thought about that. So I'll give you an example. So in the Biden administration, we had the secure communities policy that led to a lot of deportations of illegal immigrants, most of whom were men.
So explain the secure communities for those who don't live in secure communities.
Please.
Well, I was going to say, these are programs whereby the federal government partnered with state and local law enforcement officials so that individuals who essentially were getting processed by state and local officials, the federal government would be notified of that to be able to know if people who were unauthorized migrants were being caught up in the local law enforcement sector. So what happened was, some people refer to this as sort of low-hanging fruit, which was that unauthorized migrants were identified because of their interactions with local and state law enforcement and then got deported when they were not significant threats to public safety or anything else.
Right. And just the opposite would have been sanctuary cities
that
refused to share this information. Right. So if you get stopped at a stoplight, your information wouldn't be run.
Exactly.
And so this had some predicted effects, right? Like it led to a lot of deportations. Even people who weren't arrested, a lot of them went home or left the labor market out of fear of being caught. These are all the intended effects of the policy. Whether you like those effects or not, they were predictable. The surprise, and this is, I'm citing evidence by East and Velasquez and Hines and some others. I can give you that later, maybe. I gotta cite my sources. these immigrants, they supplied a lot of services like household services, cleaning services, childcare, food services, and so forth. And when they left and those services were less available, what did we see? Well, we found, these other authors found, that college-educated women with young children, so Americans with children who are less than 5 years old, younger than 5 years old, they ended up leaving the labor force as well. Right? And so this is an unintended consequence. Do you want your immigration policy to have this effect of making it more burdensome for women with young children to work? And presumably, no, that's not something that we wanted when we passed this policy. So those kinds of things are interesting to me, in telling a story to an audience that they might not have thought about otherwise.
Let me ask you, I mean, right now we're seeing, an incredibly tight labor market and lots of stories about, not being able to find workers, or wages going up in good ways in some places, unionization happening. There's a lot of, worker power. Mm-hmm. Where does migration fit into this story or not fit into this story as you think about either why we got to the place we are or perhaps what happens afterward?
Oh, that's an excellent question. Okay, so one thing, I loved Alex's opening talk, and there's one little bit that I would clarify a little bit, in that we've seen an upward trajectory of immigration, a lot of immigration flows, but COVID killed that, right? And so there's some evidence right now that the foreign-born working age population in the United States right now is 2 million below where it would have been without COVID. Okay, so that we're missing 2 million foreign workers in the working age population that we otherwise would have had. Okay, so that's a lot. And when you look at, say, like from an industry perspective, the industries that were very dependent upon foreign workers, a lot of those industries are the ones that are having a very difficult time finding employees right now, the ones that are have a lot of job vacancies. So things like hospitality and food service as primary examples. Even with higher wages and so on and so forth. Somehow I thought that was an answer to the question you were asking. So like in this current environment, immigration and what our economy can absorb or cannot absorb, I think there's a lot of room for, you know, like if more immigrants were to come in, I think that we'd have a lot of workers there.
Alex, let me go to you. And it's great to have the data, and we want to have the data, and that's important. But to translate that for non-economists, you need stories, right? So how do you find the stories? How do you report a story that brings an immigration issue to life?
I'm really interested in hearing everyone's thoughts about that, but I'll just talk from my own personal perspective. I just did a big story for Mother Jones about my alma mater, which is purported to be one of the most diverse high schools in the country. And there I followed three undocumented teenagers from Central America. The process of reporting that story, I don't know how much you guys report in schools, but you know there's this whole hierarchy and bureaucracy you have to negotiate. But I do find teachers, you know, people who have frontline experience with families and kids to be super helpful. And obviously, like in New York, there's a plethora of advocacy organizations. What I've found, and very understandably, they will sort of cherry pick stories for us. I think some of these advocates are just extraordinary, and I try to just keep in touch with them. And actually, probably the piece I've done that had the biggest impact ended up being about African teenagers who were trafficked to the United States to play basketball. And the reason I found out about it is I was reporting on DACA, and I had worked with this organization, African Legal Services, in the city. And they were like, you know, this kid just came in the other day. He was in Mississippi for 8 months, and now he's homeless. And then it turned out this guy had brought in more than 2,000 of these children to do this, and they were all over the country. So as you guys know, oftentimes it's establishing those connections to those groups. But one thing I do want to say is I feel like this work is going to be so important in the months ahead. We are going to see more people at the border. We're going to hear lots of words like tsunami and wave and crisis. I think it's really the work journalists do to get people to understand that these are people at the end of the day and not just raw numbers is going to be so important, particularly as we enter the midterm season. And I think the demagoguery we're going to see around this is going to be off the charts. So the extent to which we can get out there and meet people and tell their stories in an unvarnished way. I mean, I don't think we do anyone any favors. And look, I've been as guilty of this as anyone. Like when I was at NPR, I did a series of stories about DACA recipients, and I did a series on kids who are in medical school. They're phenomenal, but there are 128 of them nationally, right? Like that is not it's okay, not everyone has to be a superstar. You know, we're complex people. And I think the extent to which we tell these stories and show these people's humanity and, you know, the reasons that they are migrating, it is not always because someone put a gun to the head of their mother, you know? But, you know, sometimes, like, as I mentioned, the Guatemalan kids I spoke with, they're just desperate for an opportunity. I think it's important to put those stories into the public sphere, and I'm really excited to see what you guys do in the months ahead.
Well, that's a good segue to open it up to all of you. So I would like to ask for questions. We will do as we've done, I think you did last night and you did so this morning. I will point to you, I'll ask you to name who you are and your affiliation, and then ask your question for the panelists. So let me start right back there, sir.
Hello, my name is Charles Robinson. I'm with Maryland Public Television. I'm going to be a little parochial because I am from Maryland, and we do have crabs. A lot of them, but they're very expensive these days. And one of the reasons why they're expensive is because of the HB2 visas. Last year, 66,000 of those visas were vetted. We got less than 10,000 of them. Now, I'm not saying that the people who process these crabs aren't making money, because they're making a whole lot of money, because I know when I pay for crab at my local seafood place, it's like $42 a pint. I want to know, first and foremost, is this a way to get... I know it's being exploited by a lot of employers. I'd also want to know, because most of these women who come to Maryland are from the Eastern Shore and are from Mexico. I know the same occurs in places like North Carolina, Florida, and other states around the country. Are we usurping what the traditional path for migrant labor coming into the United States? Are we exploiting it? And where are these visas going?
Great. Who wants to take that? Sort of talk about these, you know, non-immigration visas, the sort of work visas that come. Do you want to talk about the economic effects or the
economics? No.
And do you want to? Or you want to just lay? Either way, you guys decide.
I'd rather start with policy.
So I think one of the things you're highlighting is, I mean, this is one of the most complicated aspects of immigration policy or temporary workers. Has not been a lot of appetite to sort of have significant temporary worker programs that employers feel are useful and productive. So one of the problems with the H-2A and H-2B programs is that employers feel that they are just cumbersome to utilize, and that the amount of, like, when they know what their workforce needs are, the program is not flexible enough or respond quickly enough to get them the workers when they feel that they need them in a timely manner. And so there's just, I think, a lot of hesitancy to actually utilize the programs that exist. So your question about sort of where are the workers going, that have been approved. Part of the problem is that I think for some employers, they just feel like by the time they get approved, it's too late. Their season for when they needed the workers has passed. And so this is one of the reasons why we see more unauthorized workers being hired to do that kind of work, because of the time frame that they can get access to that work. I think, you know, sort of the really negative history we had with the Presider program is one of the challenges to a more robust temporary worker program, but also to the fact that there's just a narrative around the fact that that is really going to displace U.S. workers. And so going back to sort of thinking about the stories that you can tell and how to think about reporting this, I think one of the really important factors is to talk about sort of how complicated, and I know this is not easy in short stories, but the fact of the matter is sort of, you talked about this, it's just so much more complicated. I mean, the story that wages went down because immigrant workers were available doesn't also address the ways in which a lot of industries have undergone significant structural changes over the years. And that as a result of those structural changes, their margins for profit have been reduced, and where they feel they can make that up is in labor. And so then they're looking for where can we find lower labor cost. And so it's not just a matter of immigrant workers being available or unauthorized workers being available, but that the structures of the industry have shifted. And so when those stories aren't told, or that aspect of the story isn't told, it's easy to just point the blame on the unauthorized workers.
Yeah, I get the I get the different visa and status groups kind of mixed up. I know kind of stereotypically a lot of people will think about like agricultural work, seasonal work, and what visas are available for that. And then they forget that there are things like dairy, where that's not seasonal. Or they'll forget about hospitality, which is seasonal but non-agricultural. And I think a lot of the decrease in visa processing that we saw in the last year or two was COVID-related, right? It was, trying to, at least ostensibly about trying to prevent the spread of disease, but also a continuation of a general anti-immigrant policy. I guess the maybe one of the central lessons that I do want to convey to you is that immigrants and natives don't compete against each other for jobs in the way that a lot of immigrant opponents fear, right? The job that you're describing is not one in which there are very many, I assume, native-born workers working in it. And so if you prevent foreign-born workers from coming in and working there, people are going to notice, not in their wages, but in the expenses of the products that they would like to buy.
Question. Let me go right here.
Hi. Karen Campbell, WTHR from Indianapolis, Indiana. Like so many other news outlets, we're focused on what's happening in Russia and Ukraine. And in terms of our viewers, it seems that they're more accepting of people fleeing their homes in Ukraine, coming to Indianapolis, finding a better way of life. Mm-hmm. There are fundraisers. There's ways to help them, as opposed to focusing on any other nationality. Say, when we talk about those in Mexico wanting to come because they're fleeing their homes too, for persecution, whatever. How can we make viewers, listeners, readers understand that, in a sense, it is the same? But again, you get that pushback when we focus on the Mexico border. Where do you see the future of immigration going in terms of that, in terms of economics, how it's going to impact the U.S.? I know you said it's going to continue for some time, it's going to grow. But when we focus on what's happening now with Ukraine versus any other nationality, why is there such, I guess, a disconnect with viewers?
I want to take this one.
I was going to give it to you.
That's an excellent question, right? And it's something that I've been hearing a lot in immigration circles. I don't know if many of you know of the group Define American, but they have a segment on their website where they talk about best practices for journalists covering immigration, which I thought was very smart and helpful. Look, there's a lot of racism behind all this, let's be honest. I mean, no one's talking about the surge at the Polish border, right? And I think in some ways this has been a moment of reflection for a lot of journalists. The people who are fleeing Ukraine, a lot of them are middle class and they're white, right? So we haven't talked about this so much, and who knows what's going to happen. But at this point, it seems like the administration is going to attempt to lift Title 42. Yeah. And I do feel like you should be the one to...
I should have mentioned that earlier, but
But we don't. I mean, basically, it was something on the books from 1949 that the Trump administration pulled out and said, ha, because of COVID, no one's coming. it's a public health crisis. There were exceptions made for unaccompanied migrants, teenage migrants. So that was when I was following these families. Insanely, mm-hmm. one of the Honduran families sent for their 13-year-old and their 8-year-old to join them because the grandmother had died and they were alone and they were without any kind of supervision. And I was like, oh my God, they're going to get mm-hmm. turned back. You're spending money you don't have to bring them over. And then in November of that year, the district court judge said, you got to stop turning away underage kids. So by like some miracle, these children came. Anyway, Title 42, if it's lifted, apparently CPB, some of their forecasts are at the high end. We could see 500,000 people at the border in a month. That's going to get a lot of attention. And so who knows what will happen? Again, like this is not all set in stone. But this is where I think the role of journalists is going to be so important. Let's talk to those people and find out why they're coming, right? Let's explain what they went through to come over here. I mean, one story that I don't think gets a lot of attention is, it's so sad, these people who sell their homes back in Central America to come and then get turned back. they are out $15,000 or, you know, they're in debt for 15 and no way of paying it back. You know, there are all kinds of, I think a lot of aspects of the that migrant experience is shrouded in secrecy. And one way to cultivate more empathy or get people to sort of understand, like, all of these people are leaving for a reason. People don't just pick up and make that horrific journey just because they feel like it, can potentially engender more understanding for the forces, about the forces that drive them over and what these people need once they're here.
And I'll just add quickly that so they did lift Title 42. and part of what was interesting was that as Ukrainians were starting to use the southern border to seek asylum, the Secretary of Homeland Security issued a memo saying, oh, by the way, don't forget, you can make case-by-case analyses of each of the cases. So Ukrainians were getting through despite Title 42, whereas Central Americans, except for unaccompanied children, were not getting through. Now, mind you, there had been long-term advocacy to revoke Title 42, and so that eventually came to the Biden administration finally did that. But the other piece I'd add to this idea about, you know, how do you sort of more universalize some of these stories is also thinking about, because I think one of the differences is between the sort of perception of Ukrainians coming, you know, fleeing the Russian invasion, it's also this sense of what is going to be the impact of a large number of Ukrainians in the United States versus what's the impact of a large number of Haitians in the United States. So we all remember what was happening, I think it was in the fall, when the Haitian immigrants were, or Haitian migrants were at the southern border. I mean, we saw CBP on horseback with whips. That's not how the Ukrainian refugees are being received. And so I think part of it is about this understanding of why people are coming, but I think the other part of it is what people think the impact of these populations in the United States are. You know, we have seen a lot of mobilizing around the idea of a minority country happening within the next 20 years, you know? And so what does it mean to see large numbers of migrants of color coming to the United States versus a number of white migrants coming to the United States? I think the concerns that people have about the shifting demographics in the United States can't be ignored here.
I was gonna jump to you and say, if 500,000 Ukrainians come or 500,000 Haitians come, what's the economic effect? What is the answer to that question? Or what would your speculation be?
So 500,000 is a huge number.
It is. I'm throwing out a big number.
But like, you know, if you're unfamiliar with the Mariel boat lift, I recommend that you read up on it. So Mariel boat lift, early 1980, a wave of about 125,000 Cubans, largely less educated Cubans, basically arriving in Miami. And so, like, if you would think that immigrants take job opportunities from Americans, like, that is where you would expect to see it. That's where you'd expect to see the wage losses. 1990, David Card, who won the Nobel Prize this last October, he had this very famous paper in 1990 saying, nope, don't see it. Don't see wage losses. And that's actually the beginning of economists starting to question whether these basic intro to econ models hold water, and you know, just an explosion of research. So you know, if it's like the Mariel boat lift, then you know, maybe everything's okay. But can I ask? I want to ask a clumsy legal question, because this issue about the Haitian migrants came up, as you said, in one of the things that part of the narrative of that Haitian event was, well, maybe these are not actually asylum seekers, refugees, that they're actually economic migrants, because they had been displaced from Haiti into South American countries and had lived there for a year or two before migrating to the United States. And I feel like whether it's U.S. law or European law, there's some sort of principle of initial settlement or something. Like, you fled violence. That's what we want from a humanitarian perspective. Anything beyond that is, oh, no, that's a different category. Am I full of it here?
No.
Or is this part of the story we should actually...
No, and so what's interesting is that there are certain... So the EU actually has sort of... And I'm blanking on the name of the policy right now. But it's this idea that you have to seek asylum in the first country of safety that you reach. I'm sorry? The Dublin Agreement. And so the United States, actually under the Trump administration, similarly tried to implement a similar agreement with certain Central American countries. So the idea was that, and I'm, you know, so that individuals would essentially have to seek asylum in one of the Central American countries that would prevent them from continuing on to the United States to seek asylum in the United States. We also have a similar agreement with Canada. So certain individuals have to seek asylum in the United States. They cannot go through the United States and then seek asylum in Canada. And so one of the challenges with these policies is whether or not that sort of first country of safety that you arrive in has a robust and effective asylum process. Because one of the concerns is that if you are in a country that doesn't have a robust legal system or a fair and accessible legal system, then your opportunity to effectively seek asylum is not very good. And so that is one of the concerns that's come up with, like, where do you have to seek asylum first? And I think the question is less about whether or not people are successful asylum applicants, but how do we treat people who are saying that they're seeking asylum? Because we have a legal process to make the determination as to whether or not somebody is entitled to asylum. That decision under our legal system is not made by Border Patrol. They conduct a credible fear interview to see if somebody should then proceed into the asylum process or if they have no credible fear and so they should be returned, but that isn't what was happening. And so the question is, why weren't the procedures followed that we have, and instead why are we having people on horseback with whips as opposed to just use the process we have?
Great. Right, a lot of questions. Let's go right here.
Hi, Kate Redmond from KVNF Radio in Paonia, Colorado, which is in western Colorado, where the temperature is rising at twice the rate of anywhere else in the United States. Our economy would not run without H-2A guest workers. And the Hispanic Affairs Project is an advocacy program there that is advancing this work to go work with the consulate of the workers' country of origin to streamline the application process and to ensure that exploitation doesn't happen at the point. Why aren't we doing this more? We're a global society, and we have access to consulates and embassies in other countries.
Okay. Why don't we work with other governments to ease this process, particularly in temporary workers? Any thoughts?
Yeah. I do have a couple of thoughts. We just published a piece by Ana Raquel Miñan at Foreign Affairs, which was excellent. She's a professor at Stanford. And we do coordinate with governments, but often it's so that people don't arrive, right? So she has done a lot of, she's Mexican. And she's done a lot of research into, you've probably seen now, right? Like, the United States has more or less told Mexico, just make sure Central Americans don't get here, okay? Do what you have to do. That apparently has a long history. They did that in the 1980s when there were all those civil wars in Central America. And apparently there are documents where Secretary of State Schultz tells them, "We'll be nicer to your Mexicans. Just make sure the Central Americans don't make it to the border, okay?" And Mexico, particularly that, had a vested interest in making sure that particularly working age men made it across the border because, I mean, look, they have a lot of problems. Shannon can go into the details of the problems of the Mexican economy, but it was in a free fall, and that is sort of an escape valve for the government, right? They're going to have to answer harder questions about how things are run if people can't feed themselves. You know what's interesting, too? I have seen certain consulates, like the Honduran consulate, during COVID, they were very active across the country, sometimes handing out free food, providing COVID tests. They understand, you know, like their number one source of income is remittances. They want people to stay here and stay healthy. I know it sounds so crass and awful, right? And it doesn't really speak to what you were talking about, but it's interesting to me as a reporter seeing how governments are active, but in a very self-interested way.
And I was just going to add that I think it depends on the community's perspective of these workers. Yeah. So I think when there is broader understanding that these workers are valuable and necessary to the community, then there's going to be more willingness to find ways to make it work. And I don't think that's true across the country.
Right. Yeah. Let me go right there in the middle, please. Yeah, go ahead with the striped shirt. Wait for a microphone and introduce yourself.
Hi, hello. So my name is Jordan Cole. I'm a current graduate student at the Columbia University's Journalism School, so I know we have in common in that aspect. And also Liz Robbins, I spoke to her like very recently as well. So she...
Oh, great.
Yeah, yeah. So she... I'm also the president of the National Hispanic Journalism Group, so I'm half Colombian, half Dominican from Miami. Worked at the Herald as a breaking news reporter before coming here to Columbia. But my question was pretty simple. Again, my experience has always been like short piece, like fast, like short term type of writing. But it was interesting last semester. I took Keith Jensen, so I did the long form piece magazine writing. But I encountered a source, right, and it was undocumented, born in Uganda, came here to the U.S. when he was 3. He's now a medical researcher at Columbia. So he has, and again, there's a lot of gaps to fill, but my question is fairly simple. It's like the approach. How, as a reporter, because there's a lot of discrepancies that come with these types of stories, and a lot of people, you know, there's not a, like a handbook, right, to like get it often correct, but how do you take into account the leniency and the sensitivity and the relevance, you know, like that's happening? I'm Hispanic, but I was born here, but I know, you know, like personally, I know communities and things like that, and I talk to them and I interact with them. But as a reporter, and this could be to you specifically, how do you approach it with sensitivity and you know, like your story with Mother Jones too, like I was reading a little bit about it, but yeah, what was that like and that process and
such a great question. I feel like we could all like have a group talk, right? That way just go for the rest of the day. Also, just so everyone knows, when he mentioned Liz Robbins, she is the director of outreach for journalists at Define American. And I think they do give talks in addition to the material that they have online. So it's worth checking them out. She's great. She's a former reporter at the New York Times who covered immigrants in the city. So I think the short answer is it requires a tremendous amount of patience. The extent to which I can embed in someone's life in a way that I'm making sacrifices for them versus them for me. So I give rides when I can. This poor kid in Northern Virginia, I mean, it was like a 15-minute ride to her place of work, and it would take her an hour and a half because she had to take 2 buses. Me giving her a ride, you know, it gave me 15, 20 minutes with her uninterrupted, and she was grateful for it. In situations, I would walk to and from homes with people. It's also... in terms of letting people say what they need to say on their own timeline, right? That's something that I had to learn the hard way. When I first started out, I'm kind of like, let's get to it, right? Like, and no one wants to be treated that way, right? We don't like it if someone said, tell us about the worst experience of your life, you know? And I'm going to put on a tape recorder while you do it. A lot of it is, and then sussing out, right? This is such an overused metaphor, but dating a little bit, right? Like, sometimes it's just not going to work. You know, the person is too traumatized, or they're being told by other people not to talk to you. So, and I always assume at least one person will drop out. And it invariably that will happen. And at first, I would find it just like... I felt like being dumped a little bit, right? You're like, we spent so much time together. How can... But I will say when you... I know. but I will say that in the grander scope of things, I've been doing this for a long time, all of that time becomes meaningful because it provides context that you bring to your stories, right? And Yeah, I think those are the major things I would say, and I'm happy to talk with you separately. And I'm thrilled you're at Columbia, and Keith is an incredible writer. You know, soak up every minute of it, because opportunities like that don't come along often.
Got it right here in the front.
Thank you. David Martin Davies, Texas Public Radio. So I've spent a lot of time on the southern border, like decades. And everything we're hearing about, you know, it's a war zone, it's a crisis, this is a danger to America. How do we as reporters try to put that in context and bring down the temperature of the rhetoric where, I mean, that is not actually what's happening, but we have politicians who say that over and over again, Fox News showing the pictures, and that's what the rest of America believes, but that's not the reality.
I think, look, you, God, you are really, you're in that zone, right? I think there, your work is so important, right? It's talking to these people about the journey that they've made, the hopes they have. Also, oftentimes, the communities that they have waiting for them, right? It's pretty rare, particularly if I focus a lot on undocumented minors, for them just to cross the border with no connections here. And giving people a sense of, like, this is a perennial story that's incredibly sad. Like, these are kids who have been separated from their parents for like a decade or more in a lot of cases. Like, what is that like? I think the extent to which we put a human face on numbers, and we should be careful, to the extent to which editors will let us be careful in using words like surge and tsunami.
Invasion.
Mm-hmm. Right? We could go on and on. There, I think, like, the work of journalists and telling stories is going to be so incredibly important. I look forward to looking at your stuff.
And I might just add, I think the other piece of it that's really important is highlighting the stories of these border communities over time. So the idea that, you know, the people who have been living in this space and who theoretically should be worried about the invasion, that they have a different perspective. And, you know, I have so many students in my class who are from border towns, and they talk about that, you know, sort of the way it gets talked about. They're like, that just wasn't my experience. That's not how I lived what my life was like in a border town. And talking about the fluidity and, you know, the ways in which that this is, you know, has been a way of life for generations, and that it is not scary. And to the extent that people get those stories, it's something to at least counterbalance the, you know, invasion stories.
I just want to add one thing. I'll break my role as a moderator. I totally agree with that. And I actually think the stories, when I have gone down to the border and border towns and spoken there, you know, the fact that Main Street is full of stores and not empty, the fact that tax bases are up because people are out shopping, like, who are the owners of that stores, of the florist, of the deli, of the places, and what are their stories, and how do they make that community much more rich, right? The good side of immigration, I think, sometimes doesn't get told, especially, you know, those that are reporting on Texas, but not from Texas.
And so I just like to look at the border in two different ways. I mean, it's where two countries are set apart, but it's also where two different countries come together.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we can not focus on the conflict, but on the shared stories.
Yeah, exactly. Next question. Let me go right here in front.
I'm Brian Horwath with the Las Vegas Sun newspaper. So I think what the missing link is here, and I'd, you know, whoever wants to comment on this, I guess maybe it's more for Alexandra, but I'm sorry to say that there's millions of people in this country who aren't ever going to read anything in Mother Jones. They're not ever going to read anything in the New York Times.
Right.
And I don't know what the answer is there. So you're talking about humanizing people and being able to present stories. There's a huge part of the population that immediately is going to shut that out. How does anybody reach those people? That's a huge population.
I don't know. Can I?
Yeah, no.
I want us to talk, but now I'm All right. So, you know, we talk about political divides in the country, right? And I think that when a lot of people who want immigration reform are doing so from, say, a social justice perspective or a diversity, equity, inclusion perspective, that those are terms that don't fly with the median voter that you need to get on your side, right? And so... You know, I think citing the stories that we've talked about here, you know, crabs in Maryland or you know, the economic activity in Paonia, I mean, these are stories that I think appeal to centrist, center-right people who can kind of relate to, like, yeah, you know, like, these people are helping me get what I want, right? I mean, voters, insofar that voters are self-interested, that story's really, really important. And so I guess I would say go that angle.
And I know the report will have more to say on this, but I just want to add to that, recognizing, even though they may not pick up a story in Mother Jones, to your point, the public is not as anti-immigrant, I think, as sometimes we are told. Because when different policies are sort of tested in their surveys, there's often much broader support than you might hear if you listen to Fox News. And so I guess I would also just say that group of people who are just sort of the heck no, never, is much smaller than we actually, I think, sometimes think. And so there is a broader group of people who are open. And to your point, like, the stories that are open, that there is space for people who are sort of in the middle and unsure, even though there are a group of people who may never want to support any of this and will never see immigrants as human, but they are not the majority.
Yeah, I wonder if your stories are somewhere the place to start, because as you find in your research, economically, it's a pretty good deal in a lot of different categories, and so maybe that's sometimes the place to start, because it comes down to the pocketbook.
It is, and when I talk to, like, kind of regular non-academic folks, like, about, oh, immigration's good, you know, what are their hang-ups? Well, you know, they'll cite the Reagan amnesty, and they say, we were promised amnesty once and never again, right? And so, you know, for that person, pathway to citizenship, excluding DACA, that's off the table. Are you willing to compromise, right? And so, yeah, I mean, I think that there are areas where compromise is possible and areas where, yeah, it's still going to be divisive.
Time for one more question. Let me go right here with the mask, please.
Hi, I'm Sherry McWhorter. I write for MLive in Michigan. And this question's a little more economic rather than the personal stories of immigration. We hear a lot about inflation lately. It's off the charts. What would inflation be like if we had those 2 million workers that aren't here because of COVID? If we had the workers here who hadn't been turned away because of government programs, what might it look like now for the everyday person in America going to the grocery store dealing with inflation?
There's a paper, maybe it's about a decade old, by Patricia Cortez, where she looks at what happens to the prices of goods and services that are predominantly provided by immigrants. I mentioned before, like, childcare, healthcare, or maybe I didn't say healthcare, but childcare, food service, construction work, and that sort of thing. Immigration inflows into those sectors reduce prices of those goods and services. So at least in certain sectors, yes, if we had the 2 million more immigrants that we're missing, I think that you would see less price pressure in those sectors. Very well could. I don't think gas prices are going to be affected, but otherwise, yeah.
But our crab would be less.
But our crab would be cheaper.
Okay. Yes. For our next trip to Maryland, Flynn. We have come to the end of our time. You now all have a break for about half an hour, but we'll be back here for table topics at 1 p.m. And I would imagine, I know I didn't get to all the questions, there were a lot of hands, but I imagine people here would be happy to take those questions one-on-one. But for now, please join me in thanking the panel.